In this video in my Logisim series, I'll show the addition of a hardware call stack to make subroutine calls easier. I'll also show Java versions of the various Windows programs I wrote, such as the simulator, and also another version of Logisim which has some interesting components. Furthermore, I'll show various ways of creating a compiler for a CPU design, and also some nice scenes I created, so be sure to watch all of this video. I created a simple test program that repeatedly prints program list, but with various parts of the phrase printed by different nested subroutines. Here's the new program counter circuit, which now also contains a hardware call stack. You can see the program counter values pushed onto the stack, which is the RAM, and popped off the stack back into the program counter. This way, the CPU keeps track of where it has to go back to when it hits a return. And since it's a stack, nested subroutine calls work correctly. Here's the new call and return instructions. And here's the test programs, both for the repeating and non-repeating program list message. You can see how the parts of the phrase are printed in different subroutines. If you saw one of my previous videos on gated clocks, you'll know I removed all the unnecessary gated clocks by using the main clock instead. Unfortunately, I had to use a gated clock in this new stack. I tried every combination, and there was no way to get a non-gated clock to work. The problem is that with a gated clock, the stack pointer counter can be rising edge. The program counter is falling edge. Therefore, the stack can operate before the program counter needs the value. If you try to have the stack pointer counter use the main clock, the counter has to be falling edge. Therefore, there's no way for the correct stack value to get to the program counter in time. By the way, I had to add two new control lines to the CPU for push and pop. And as usual, the control ROM had to be edited to add the new instructions. Here's the old and new Raytracer code. With no hardware call stack, I had to load the label for the instruction after the jump into a register and store it in a memory location. Then at the end of the subroutine, I jump back to the location stored in memory. Now I just use call and return. Here's the new design in Logisim Evolution. It has slightly different wiring on the stack circuit due to the differences in the RAM component. If you saw my previous video, you may remember I said that I wasn't crazy enough to write recursion in assembly language with no hardware stack, so the Raytracer only traced primary and shadow rays. Now that I have a hardware call stack, I was willing to add a single level of reflection. There is still no refraction though, and no multiple levels of reflection. The green ball is now reflective. For this Logisim demo, I chose to render a more interesting area of the scene, since I knew it would take a long time to calculate. These 18 rows of the scene took 24 hours, and this is what Logisim would have shown if I hadn't stopped it. This is using my graphical simulator. Here's the full scene in full resolution. I programmed it to move the balls in different directions and move one of the lights to the left. By the way, the magenta ball is more specular or shiny than the other balls. The scene is getting darker because the brighter light is moving away. I've put the new Raytracer assembly language code at the end of this video. I wanted to create a hardware user stack so you could push and pop any data you wanted. This could be used for subroutine parameter passing and also temporary variables. The problem is that in the current design, there's no way to get the stack contents into a register. All the slots, so to speak, are taken. With the Y register, I would have to make the MUX and the encoder 8 input, but there's no room left to do that. I would have to make subcircuits. Same problem with the A register. If you saw my Verilog video, you'll know I did have to change the A register configuration to include a 4-input encoder, so there would be enough slots, but still no room. Maybe in a future version I'll make the necessary subcircuits. By the way, using the call stack as a user stack as well is something that could be done, but would have the same space problems as a separate user stack. Now I'll show the Java versions of the programs I wrote. Here's the assembler. Here's the control ROM program to calculate the values to put in the control ROM. They work the same as their Windows counterparts. And I also wrote a Java version of my graphical simulator shown earlier in this video. The timer and fast mode options work a little differently. By the way, in Java, I'm not aware of any way to get access to the actual event loop, so the only way to do the non-timer method was to create another thread that repeatedly calls the instruction execution routine. rather than using a timer to call the routine. This is necessary because the smallest amount of time for a timer is 1 millisecond, which would result in a 1 kHz clock at best. The Java version has all the features of the Windows version except the ability to ensure only one instance of the simulator is open at a time, and the window resizing isn't as pretty. But an added feature is the ability to change the look and feel. The menus and GUI elements look different. By using Launch4j, you can make an executable of your Java program, so you won't have to type the Java command. You'll still need Java installed to run the resulting program, though. Now for the compiler section of this video. For an assignment in my compilers class in college, I wrote a simple compiler with an LL1 parser that compiles simple arithmetic expressions. Variables starting with A and B are integer numeric variables. Ones starting with C are logical, and ones starting with D are string. It parses the input and generates the code. I modified it to generate code for my CPU. I had to use the non-optimizing version of my compiler since the optimizing one requires more registers. Due to the register limitations, I also had to add extra instructions in the generated code, so it is definitely not optimized code. I also added floating point capability to my compiler. Variables starting with F and G are floating point, and I also made the variable names a little less restrictive. I took the generated code and made a wrapper for it. The wrapper sets the variables to particular values. Note the expected final value was calculated by hand to make sure the program works. It should be hex 11280F. And sure enough, the Y register has the right value. Now for the floating point version. The result should be around negative 19,486.53125. The value is a little off because of the compounded round-off errors due to the limited precision of 32-bit floating point numbers. This time, the final value can be seen using the floating point probe on the Y register. It is what was expected. This isn't a very versatile compiler, so let's look at other ways to write a compiler. There's a website that has grammars for known languages such as Pascal, C, and Ada. There's also another website that has a Yak or Bison grammar file for ANSI C. And the associated LEX or FLEX scanner file. These can be used to easily create a parser for the C language. Yak creates an LALR1 parser. Here's how I use these files with Bison and LEX on Linux. It successfully parsed the sample program. The code generation part would be the hard part. There are also various retargetable C compilers, such as LCC. With LCC, you can specify how your CPU codes the various operations. Still not easy, but doable. You really need a CPU design that has multiple registers, all with the same type of capabilities, and a hardware user stack, in order to do this step well. Now for another version of Logisim. This is the Logisim ITA fork. It has some nice added components, such as the oscilloscope. And by using the Puck Tools jar library available at their website, there are even more components, including some floating point operations. This Logisim version also adds some nice parameters to various memory components, etc. I guess a slider component would be useful here for this. Now for some eye candy. I took the simple scene I created for my CPU's assembly language Raytracer and improved it using the full Raytracer I wrote in C. Here's the result. This time the green ball is glass. And here's a scene I created for another video. The videos on the walls, etc. are from my various YouTube videos. And here's the new Raytracer code. By the way, if I had to create another CPU design from scratch, I would have more registers and have the registers accessed in a uniform way, all having the same possible inputs and possible outputs, including register-to-register transfer capability, and of course a fully usable hardware general purpose stack. This way, it would be a lot easier to retarget a C compiler for my CPU.